Hello, I'm Tom.
I'm Matty.
And I'm Lewis.
And this is The Wigan Way. So, you join us after round 12. Wigan played Leeds at the DW on Friday, the 12th of May. It was poor. The Rhinos coming out, eventual winners, 40 points to 18. Wigan were winning 14-6 at the half time point. Try scorers for Wigan were Ian Thornley, Bevan French and Abbas Miski. Harry Smith kicked 3 goals. For the Leeds Rhinos, Liam Tindall, Cameron Smith, Rhys Martin, Harry Newman got a double, Richie Myler and Tom Holroyd, with Martin kicking 6 goals. Now, that is as bad of a second half as I've seen in a long time, lads. It's it was really, really difficult. They were down to 12 men. Tete Vanhoof been sent off for a high shot on Harry Smith. I don't know how Harry Smith came back after that. He seemed like he struggled a little bit coming back on. Made a mistake and then felt like he was overplaying, but that's not enough of an excuse to warrant conceding 36 points in the second half and losing like that. So, lads, I'd be keen to hear your points on this.
Yeah, well, first half, I thought we were absolutely dominant. It was like the leads we've seen of the last few weeks. Not very good. No creativity, nothing going forward, no meters. We just walked all over them the whole first half. Their only try was a gift. An interception. And at that point, I'm thinking, right, well, that's the only way they can score. Then we should win this quite handily. Tete Vanhoof gets a red card, like you said. Harry Smith has to go off. And at that point, I'm worried about Harry Smith missing a next game. And maybe the players were as well, because we come out after the second half, perhaps thinking, we'll win this easily now. We've been on top for 40 minutes. They've not had a sniff. They're down to 12. We'll just roll them. And then we'll try and beat them again next week. And that's the only thing I could think of, because we just gifted a momentum. And Leeds are a team that I've seen play like no other, with momentum at the heart of their team. It's ridiculous how hot and cold they are based on whether they've got momentum or not in the game. And we gave it to them at the start of the second half, absolutely handed it to them.
They don't need a second invitation, do they? No, give them a chance.
But we wrestled it back. We worked so, so hard to wrestle it back. Thornley went in with a great try. We're level. We've wrestled back the momentum. And then just to hand it straight back to them the next set. Sets up the points. You all have mentioned it, Lewis. Give them another interception try. Just ridiculous, really. It's horrible.
You're right in what you're saying, Matty. The one thing I noticed about that second half, and I've noticed this, they did this to us last year when we played in the semi-final at our place, and they beat us and they went to Old Trafford. Leeds get on top of us when the game is quick. Mm. And when they play their pace, like you said there about momentum, they return up, they run over, it's quick play of the balls, it's offloads, it's at you, and Wigan can't cope with it. And I think Wigan dominated in the first half because we played the game at our pace. Wigan like to more kind of take your runs in structure, balls back on the inside, plays, it's more kind of structured, whereas Leeds kind of are just off the cuff, offloads, quick play of the balls, no, and it's that very
athletic. My big worry was we get back in the game with Harry Smith, with Ian Thornley's try in the second half.
And well taken try. Well,
was it 18 points to 12 at that point?
Well, we got back, it was at 18-14.
18-14,
and we missed a kick and we got level 18 apiece with that try, because we missed a kick because it was right on the touchline.
And then they'd been rolling us and rolling us and rolling us and quick, and then we tried to match them. We tried to keep the game going quick. We're throwing cut-out passes. We're doing whatever. Putting kicks in. Not kicking long. Not backing our defence like we've done over the last 10 weeks. Last 2 seasons.
Spring to mind, you think? lobbing face balls around town. I mean, how many intercepts? Well, it's three intercepts.
It was two from Smith, from
Cust at the very end.
Three intercept tries and a try where Tom Holroyd just gets a ball from nine and crashes over. And then another one, the kick that we didn't deal with, and it just bounced the ball and they went and caught it and done. That is five.
So you'd say we'd give him five.
Soft try. You cannot be giving five tries away in that manner. Three intercepts, not dealing with a kick. A nothing kick as well. There's only a ball up in the air. It takes someone to put it in and it catch it. Let it bounce.
I do wonder with Harry Smith for that kick, because he's the one that lets it bounce. He'd just come back on after his HIA and he never seemed to get his feet right under it. Makes the mistake, which is going to happen. People are going to make mistakes. But then he overplays. He tried to get one back. We score the Thorley try, but then he tries to put a cut-out ball, and you're just thinking, you're fine now, you've evened it out, it's 1-1, you made a mistake, done something really positive.
Yeah.
Go back to being boring. There was no one to really grab us by the scruff of the neck and just say, listen, these men don't want a slow game. As soon as we got it back to 18-18, we should have put that ball dead, we should have kicked it to the touches, pinned him in a corner if they could recover the ball.
Got back in the arm wrestling.
And got into a wrestle, slowed him down. We have the extra man. We dictate the speed of the game.
And they defended 15 minutes on their own line in the first half. Mm-hmm. And we scored through Miski, I think it was. Yeah. But before that, when it was 0-0, they defended a lot. So if we'd have stuck with them for the first 10 minutes of the second half, they would have tired very easily.
Well, that first half showed, because Leeds didn't want to get, like you mentioned, an arm wrestle there. I don't think Leeds didn't want to get in an arm wrestle that first half, and that's why we dominated. You're right, Duke, they were throwing the ball. I said to you, there was on their own line, and they're not putting their hand up and taking tough carries. They're doing 1-2 passes, floating balls over top to the winger, trying to get a break on the outside, not prepared to do the hard stuff. Wigan go on, like you say, Matt, to dominate. They get gifted a try off an intercept. Then Tetaverno gets sent off. Then they started going to get into a bit more building pace, some finding some offloads. We couldn't deal with it with the ruck. We couldn't slow them down. And they got on top, and
worse. Problem, they get on top, we get back in it.
We work really hard to get back in it.
Really hard to get back in it, get level. And then we go, all right, we've scored now playing at this pace.
Mm.
We'll keep going at this pace. We'll keep trying to outscore you. And for 90% of the teams, I think that's all right. Because you've got the extra man, you've got French, all these players, so much pace. But for Leeds, a team that when they get momentum are so destructive, we just had to kill the game for 10 minutes and go, right, we're going to make you make tackle after tackle. We'll kick dead, defend our 40, and then we'll have an attacking kick that gets us a 6 again, or a goal line dropout, or we'll make you make 20 tackles on your line. Because they don't hold up under that pressure. I kept saying to you, Lewis, in that game, if we get a repeat set, I'm backing us to score.
Yeah.
Because I just didn't fancy them to keep being able to turn up. Down to 12 men, the options that we were throwing at them, they just didn't, to me, feel like they had that ability to keep doing it and keep doing it. They want to go length of the field, quick, almost passive tackling. We're not going to fight in these tackles. We're going to play touch rugby and keep this game alive. And we tried to outdo it. It just didn't seem like the game plan went to went out the window. We went to playing this style. And maybe we cost.
We played
back.
Their game, didn't we? Mm. We got drawn into playing their game, letting them control the pace of it, besides us taking control of it in that second half. And I think that's what got us down. I think, obviously, we're playing again on Saturday, which we'll get to, but I think the big point is going to be you have to slow them down. You've got to dictate the pace. Mm. You've got to win the ruck. If you do that, they're going to struggle. They want to get on top. They want to play quick, throw off loads, scoot some dummy half and quick, playing flat and fast. You've got to control that and do your best to.
On those interceptions, the last one from Kay Cuss, when I think it was Havard, put him through a gap, that's the defender was still in the defensive line. That's just a horrible forward pass. That wasn't really like the other two. The other two were Newman jumping up at the right moment, timing it perfectly to basically pinch Wigan's pocket. Now, do you guys see that as Harry Newman's been doing his homework? And then the follow-up question to that would be, is Smith going to be this week second-guessing himself, not throwing that face ball? Does Newman then hang back? it's really becomes like a game like a cat and mouse, doesn't it, really?
It's very much a game of cat and mouse, but watching Leeds and what I've seen of Harry Newman, he seems like a player that would want to do that. He likes to be the main man, he likes to make big plays, and I can see him going for it again. That, for me, early on, every time Newman steps out, he's got a Pepper Farrell on that short ball.
Yeah, or Piers Paul, or whoever
it is. Whoever that second rower is, he's got to get to the four-in defender, let Newman shoot out as the second defender in, and whoever's that third defender for Leeds, Farrell's got to hit his outside shoulder in the gap that Newman's left and ensure that Newman's jumping out the line, and we're going to keep hitting him short, we're going to keep hitting him short. Maybe hit French on an extra play, maybe a short player out the back.
Kicking behind, turning around.
Say a little kicking behind. The best way to solve a kind of quick attack is a little kicking behind, especially if you're near the line, because then that makes you think, right, I can't jump up now, because if I do jump up and they put it behind me, I'm not fair back enough to recover that
but
ball.
But both his interceptions were from nearly the halfway line. They're not 90 metres he's got.
No, I think the thing with Harry Smith is you can't... If he goes into Saturday's game questioning, oh, do I throw the ball, do I not, he's going to have another awful game. Mm.
Yeah.
He has to get it out his head, play his own game. And I'm not saying, doesn't mean be wary of it and just, again, make the same mistakes. But like you said, just throw a couple of short balls early on. Like you're saying, just keep it simple. Get into a game, get into a four, couple of short balls, get him questioning, mix it up then, maybe a long ball, a face ball, little kicks in behind. Just keep him guessing, essentially, is what I'd say.
That's sort of what I mean with the French situation. I'd possibly take a short play early on, maybe down a blind side, and make a 4-on-3 where you've got Smith, Farrell, or Smith, Wardle, Thornley, and French out the back to say, go on, if you're jamming on Wardle and go for that interception play, I'm just going to get French out the back and we score. I think that's maybe just a bit of an early play to say, I know what you're looking out for. I know you're going to try and shoot out. Because the moment you shoot out, I'm either hitting French here or I'm hitting Wardle short and we're going through that gap.
Yeah.
I think making a point of, nah, this is my game. You don't keep doing that to me. I've worked you out now. And try and target him defensively. I think he's a very, very good player. But I don't think any player in the world wants to be doing 30, 40 tackles. I'd have Farrell, I'd have Smith all running over the top of him, putting that pressure on him to try and take some of his attacking ability, not let him play the game on his terms.
Yeah.
So on French, speaking of great players, I don't think he was 100% fit this game. Thought it chasing back on Newman for the first try. I thought when he got free... There was one time he got free and he got caught. I thought, he doesn't look 100% fit. He wasn't popping up in these places where he usually pops up. And the past few weeks I've said it's because he's been playing full 80 minutes at fullback and he's been having a lot of work to do. And that is true. Teams have given him a lot of work to do. He desperately misses his partner in crime, doesn't he? This whole team does.
Yeah.
He can't do it by himself. Nobody can. He needs the two of them. He needs somebody else to shoulder the creativity.
But this for me now, I'm going to slightly disagree with you. This is where Acosta's got to step up.
Oh, he misses somebody.
Yeah.
Not necessarily Jay Field.
I get that Field is the attacking threat.
Field is the best one at that, but he misses somebody to do that.
But this is what I think. Harry Smith and Acosta this week, especially for the first 15, 20, 25 minutes, I'd be using French almost as a dummy play. Step and go, keep teams honest, and then hit him later on. I just think maybe take away that little bit of out the back and go, we're going to run over the top of you. I'm going to run over the top of you. Custard in his running game. We're going to keep going at you. We're going to keep hitting Wardle and King on short balls. And then later on when the game starts to open up, he's not as targeted as much and French becomes a bit more of an option. I just think maybe take a little bit of that attacking impetus on them too.
I think it's with Smith and Cuss together, because they seem like a very similar type of halfback. Like, if you put Field and Smith in there, for example, like normally, I know it's kind of, I'm not saying this is how it has to be, but normally you always have a more kind of a running threat and an organiser. Yeah, look at George Williams,
drink water
at Warrington, for example. Whereas Cust and Smith, they tend to be the organisers. They both can have a kicking game with them, who can do it. And it's like, I think Field and Smith is a kind of one where we have the running threat in Field and we have the kind of organiser in Smith. And I want to see Cust on Saturday. I know, obviously, again, this was his first game back from an injury where he's not played in a fair bit. So we've got to cut him, you know, a bit of slack in his first game back. And he did come in off the bench, didn't he? Shorrock started there. But I want to see him have a good game Saturday because I'm rooting for him. I think he's a good player. I want him to do well. He's coming under a bit of stick. Obviously, there's a lot of pressure on him. He's an Aussie import, so we do expect a lot of him. But I do want to see him. I want to see him have a good game.
The thing for me is I want to see his running game back.
Not scared to wear a tackle.
Run first, pass second. At the start of last season, he really impressed me because he came with that big left foot step.
Yeah,
and went at teams and he kept them honest in the middle.
And you know what, that's part of the reason Jay Field scored so many tries at the start of last season is because Cust and Farrell just peppered left side defence.
Yeah, they kept so honest.
For 2 months they just peppered the left side defence, kept them honest like you said, and then Field could be the beneficiary there. And I think that's what I'm missing as well, is that running half, that running game. Think about Ellen Road, the try scored, and it very often didn't lead to a try, but it was the play after, or the one after in the second half, where actually he doesn't run it, but he takes it to the line and he pops it out the back.
I think that,
or he plays it short to Farrell.
When Cust puts that big step on, you get a defence just moving laterally. He puts the big step on, straightens everyone up. Then there's the panic of, oh, he's gone. He's not it, French, or he's not it, Fielder, he's not it, Smith. He's gone. You get two men jumping back to try and help out, and you get an extra man stuck in the marker. And most of the time that I see of him, he either keeps his feet or gets us a decent play of the ball. And that then means your third man who's jumped in on Cust, because there's the panic of he's going to get through this gap, he's suddenly trapped at marker or trapped around the play of the ball, and you can create an overlap elsewhere. And then you're going maybe a Smithies or a ball-playing prop to Smith to French. That extra man that's just been dragged in by an honest play, that really does create a little bit of space. Now,
let me ask you this. What, reviewing this game, the good thing is we've got the chance to correct it on Saturday, haven't we? Because we're going there, and if we can go and again now turn them over at their ground in the cup, that kind of, again, it's a one apiece then, isn't it? You know, we answer our kind of critics after two losses back-to-back, Hull away, Leeds at all. If we can go and get a win at Headingley in a cup, that's obviously a massive way to bounce back and give a receipt out.
Yeah.
What do we need to do? Obviously, we probably need to do a lot of things differently, but what do you think are the big kind of things we need to change going on to Saturday?
We need to quiet the crowd.
Yeah.
They'll be bouncing.
Headingley will be bouncing. It always is. And if they get a couple of quick tries, it could very quickly get ugly. That's the same for any team that goes to Headingley. I'm not saying that. That's not doom and gloom for Wigan. That's any team that goes to Headingley. If you let them get a couple of quick tries, the fans are going to get excited. They're going to start willing their team on, and Leeds play like the 90s Brisbane Broncos when their fans are on cheering them, you know.
The thing for me is I don't want them. I was worried about our bench. Cust, O'Neill, Mago. Who else was on the bench? Cust.
Was it O'Neill not on the bench?
Cust, O'Neill, Mago and Piers Paul.
Because Ison Farrell started.
I potentially want to see Havard on the bench. I think he's a prop that comes on after 20 to 25 minutes and then ultimately plays till the 80 minute goes. And he gives you 60 minutes non-stop. You rotate your props around him. I think he really shows us up for that middle 15-20 either side of half time.
I'm with you.
Now, whether that means you have to start, because we're going off the assumption of we've got Byrne, Havard, Mago as our available props. Mago has to play on the bench.
Yeah.
For me.
Yeah, he's going to struggle. He's not
so starting.
He was shouldering a lot of the load this week, which I said last week, Mago and Hill had to do lots of big minutes. And I just, I don't trust him to do that many minutes.
I think that bench has got to be I would either start with a Smithies or an Iser at prop. And now I know they're not the biggest, but you've got Byrne. You're playing either Farrell, who'll make his metres and do his tackling. Iser or Piers Paul at second row. Shorrocks at 13. And you ask Shorrocks, he's got to do 80 minutes there, or the best part of it.
You've got your answer when Marshall gets back. Abbas Miski can play prop.
He runs it in like a prop.
And did you see when Bentley tried to tackle him, he knocked himself out 100 miles an hour. Miski, because he's Lebanese and he doesn't know any different, just hops straight back up.
Mm.
Roles reversed, that's probably a red card.
Mm. Yeah.
No, it shouldn't be. But that probably is if the roles are reversed. But Miski is just head like granite.
Mm.
And Bentley picked the wrong man.
I just think, going back onto that, the one prop that can play 60 to 65 minutes for me is Ethan Havard.
Well, I suppose Cade Ellis could.
But he's not fit. I'm going off who's fit here.
Off who's available.
So then, my safe bet is to play him for the last 20 second half rather than bringing him off. You could be in control of the game, bring him off and lose it 10 minutes either half, and then you're asking him to regain momentum. If he comes off the bench, he can dictate how that game goes. Now, he's not going to go over the top of people and make 25 metres carries. He's not that type of prop. But the subtleties in his step and his ability to land on his front, get a quick play of the ball, get us some momentum and get through his defensive work, I just think that gives us a bit more balance to then play Mago, to then play have Shorrocks at 13 and use either Smithies or Iser as that prop forward. Now, we're going to give our teams out later. I would be looking at Byrne, Powell, probably Iser though, Faz and Piers Paul,
yeah.
Smithies at 13.
Mm.
Smithies has got to do 60, 80 minutes.
Mm.
And if I was spelling him, I'd play Powell straight on at 13 and give 10 minutes either half-time or before half-time for Smithies.
For O'Neill to be on the pitch.
For O'Neill to get on at 9, Powell goes straight to there, but then Smithies has got to play the last 40
because
you need 40 tackles out of him.
And you need a fresh Powell as well. You can't put too much on Powell, especially in the middle of the park.
I just think Havard then gives you the option of rotating Byrne, Mago, Iser, Shorrocks on the bench, because if you needed to spell Smithies a prop, it just gives you a bit of flexibility.
That seems a lot more balanced. I think it's a more balanced team there and a more balanced bench. It looked a bit strange having O'Neill and Cust on the bench this last week and Piers Paul. You know, you've only got the one prop. But I think that was just needs must, really. We have only got three.
We're missing a lot of bodies. I think the disappointing thing was, if that game was close all the way through, we lost it at the end, we could say, you know what, with a fit team, we have enough to hold out that game.
Mm.
I think the disappointing thing was here was we had the position to win the game.
Yeah.
We did the hard work in the first half. They went down to 12 men. It was there for the taking.
It was just
and
a
that's
complete,
why it's disappointing.
It was
obviously, we will be a lot better when we get bodies back. But the fact that we was in control of that game at half time and let it slip is what's the most. That's the bitter pill to swallow. And the man, like I said before, 5 tries gifted to us.
Yeah, I agree.
No. That's the bitter pill.
There's been no more news about Ellis and Singleton. I think Ellis is 2 weeks away, isn't he?
Well, Field is 2 weeks as well.
Singleton is another 4 or so. Would you be in the market for going and getting another prop if one came available?
Oh, only if it was the right one. Obviously, Singleton won't be around next year.
Mm.
Cooper wants to carry on, wants to play on. He was quoted last week saying he wants to carry on. I really hope he does, but whether he does or not, we don't know. That we're in a bit in the dark over Cooper. Mago, Ellis, off contract. One of them probably gets kept, one of them doesn't. So I would be in the market for a prop if it was the right one.
It's got to be in the market for it. It's got to be a long term.
Absolutely.
It's not because we've got injuries, we'll go and buy one, because I'm not being funny. You've waited. For me, it's only 2 weeks left until you're getting one of them back. So for me, if you're going to go buy a prop, it's got to be who's in your long-term plans, thinking not just about this season finishing, but after when Singleton will go and maybe Mago and Ellis will go. It's got to be a long-term plan. It's not just because we're low on bodies.
If you're
waiting for Luke Thompson, for example, wait for Luke Thompson. Don't bring somebody in now.
Yeah.
You can wait. If the right person isn't available now, you can wait.
One that I'd love is Ryan Sutton. He doesn't seem to be getting a game in.
No, but he has been out with an injury, they've confirmed, and I think he will be back in this week. He played reserves this week. He's very settled. He's just got Australian citizenship. His Australian partner just had twins. Very settled in Australia. I think, to be fair, listening to him speak when he signed for the Bulldogs, I was looking at one of his old interviews this week. He said it's been a dream of his to come to Australia for like as long as he can remember. And it's always known that, and Wigan always knew that. And it was just a means to an end. And you know what? We got a few good years out of him. And we've prepared him for it is. But the lad is in Australia. He's loving life. I don't blame him.
Fair play to him.
I think he's just one that I have a bit of a thing that I'd love him back.
Well, I like it all. He's a good player, isn't he?
He's fantastic, and he'd add a lot to the team. But
when he's fit, do you think he gets anywhere near the England squad?
Absolutely, I think he does. Especially with some of our better props over the years, perhaps being a bit long in the tooth. I'm thinking Alex Walmsley, Chris Hill, those guys have been fantastic servants. Cooper as well, yeah, fantastic players for England. But obviously, if we're looking at the next World Cup and the next cycle, they're not going to be
29-30.
Yeah, they're not going to be in that. So Thompson, Sutton, Matty Lees, those are your guys' props really going forward, I think. Maledsky.
Yeah, can't disagree.
I definitely think Sutton will be in with a shout there.
Yeah. So that wraps up the disappointment of Wigan versus Leeds.
Yeah, you can tell Wigan lost because we started talking about Ryan Sutton.
Yeah, we'll take it off the topic very quick.
Wigan anymore. Yeah. Off topic.
Do we have to fill this episode?
Yeah.
Thank you for listening. It must have been painful to listen to. I fully understand.
We'll go again
next week, but we'll come back in a minute and we'll listen to. We'll talk about the rest of Super League. So thank you. So we are back looking at the rest of round 12. We're going to start off on a Thursday. A real thriller at the Bewell Support Stadium. Wakefield versus Hull FC. This was, I think I ended up, I didn't do it, did I? I didn't back Wakey in the end.
You didn't?
I couldn't do it.
I remember
they lost 26-6.
Shock horror.
It was 6-0 at half time, really close. I don't think it was close because both sides were playing great rugby. Lots of handling errors, a few mistakes. But then again, then in the second half, Hull FC sort of ran away with it. A little bit of skill from like Clifford, a little bit too much ability to roll forward with the likes of Scott Taylor and Liggy Sow.
Sutcliffe scored a nice try.
But that question asks again, when will Wakey win a game? I just can't even see him winning Challenge Cup this week.
It was so weird. Like after the game, or was it before the game? Michael Carter, the CEO who's departing, was saying, well, basically, we're going to get relegated and it's fine because we'll get a higher grade than any Championship clubs anyway. So we'll be back up in no time. What a negative attitude that is for the club to hold. They're just fine with relegation. Like, sure,
that's not good for the league and the game as a whole, is it? When you've got teams with just saying, we get relegated, that's fine.
It's just sure.
Is that a true statement? Would they get a better grade?
I don't know. They're betting on it because that new stand is good, but it's only 1 out of 4.
But it's empty.
The LFC fans still have
problem. To.
They're not open it yet. It's still not open.
It's not open.
It's not
finished. But they're saying it's going
to... No, because the pitch wasn't finished for the start of the season and neither was the new stand and that's still not finished.
So I can't see him getting a win. They've also let go the assistant coach, the attacking coach.
Yeah, James Ford. Yeah. He's going to be a CEO,
aren't he? Is it at Featherstone?
Director of rugby, yeah.
At Featherstone.
He was one of the brightest young coaches. Like, he was always linked with the Leeds job when Agar left. And he was linked with the Cast job this time that ended up going to Andy Last. But a bright young coach, James Ford, at one time. And it's kind of sad to see that. He's departed quite sourly from Wakefield.
I think there's an issue when you're an attacking coach and...
You keep getting nilled.
not to sound too harsh, but this might just save Applegrath. In all reality, he should probably be gone. And they should be bringing in a coach to set up for the next 2-3 years.
They're not sacking Applegarth. I'm telling you now, they're not sacking Applegarth.
No.
Having listened to the CEO before the match, there is no chance to sack Applegarth. He's got the keys to the city, really, because they like what he did with the academy. They think he's the man to bring them back into Super League once they get relegated. I know it's a negative attitude, horrible mindset, but that's where they're at the minute.
I think it's a Wigan, if they sack him, it just shows, because obviously the fans wanted Billy Poaching staying, didn't they?
Yeah.
And I think actually to sack Applegarth after you've let Poaching go, everyone's going to be saying, well, what on earth was the point? Do you get what it's a lose.
Should have just kept Billy Poaching.
Exactly. So that I think it'll show a bit of maybe incompetency on their part if they were to sack him now, because they've got to admit they've made a mistake in letting Poaching go and but having Applegarth.
It's not like it's one mistake. They brought Luke Gayle in. He's still not played. They brought him in as an immediate fix, or is he going to be the new attacking coach? Is he going to basically do that role?
Luke Gayle was up on the balcony prancing about like he was Wakefield's saviour. Mm. And if I was a player for Wakefield and I'd been beaten every game so far this year, but I was still putting in good effort, which they are doing. And
We're not trying.
We were getting beaten again by Hull FC, and I was underneath my own post and I looked up at the coaching box and I could see Luke Gayle prancing about the talking to everybody in the coach's ear all the time. I'd be thinking to myself, get on here and sort this out. Yeah. If you're the man you keep saying you are, get down here and sort us out.
He's been brought in to help fix them. Now, whether that is to help Applegarth develop and get some on-field coaching, or whether that's to become an immediate fix on the pitch, he has to be playing.
Well, he is a player, isn't he? He should be fixed on the... Because he's been brought in, and Applegarth said we've signed him because we're after the other half-back for Mason Leno. Exactly. We need another half-back. So then to bring him in, he's not playing. Has he given a reason for it? Is he kind of not?
No. He said Morgan Smith, who partnered Leno the game before, played so well that it would be a shame to drop him. But they still got beat, though.
Then why go by Gayle if you've got faith in Morgan Smith?
Morgan Smith, I don't want to put it on him.
No, it's not his fault. But like Matt, it's just that they're making mistakes as a club. The pitch, the stand, whatever you want to say. The fact that they keep, we've mentioned these things before, where they've gone away from this now, but signing 2-week loans, and we're not a fan of that. They've let Corey Hall go to Hull KR and got Will Dagger. And I'm not saying Will Dagger's not a good player, but we've seen Corey Hall's performing well with Hull KR. Was that the right decision? I can see a lot of Wakefield fans saying probably no. No, I would have rather kept Corey Hall.
They've brought Luke Gayle in. He's either fit or he isn't. If he's not fit, it's a stupid decision. If he is fit, it's an even bigger stupid decision not to play him. Because he makes Leno better. Now, you might have to go speak to Morgan Smith and say, listen, he's a young lad, we're really sorry, but the club's in a terrible position, it's nothing on you. We'll try and get your game time, whatever. We'll send you out loan to the Championship.
Well, I think he was playing centre, to be honest, Tom, when they had a set half-back pairing at the start of the season. I think Smith was playing centre.
Yeah, but then they put Liam Gaskell there. Is it Liam Gaskell?
Lee Gaskell. Yeah.
Who's going to play centre now because he was playing as the half-back. They're going to keep Dagger at full-back. Who I've been impressed with.
Well, he's a good player.
I think he's tried and he's left everything on the pitch.
Like Lewis said, he's not a bad player. He's just unfortunate that he got swapped for Corey Hall. It's not his fault.
No, and there's nothing wrong out of the Applegarth grabbing this young Morgan Smith, like taking towards the time, just saying, look, I'm doing this and bringing in Gayle, not because you're not playing well, not to drop you, but I want to take a bit of pressure off your shoulders.
You should be able to have a week off.
Halfback's a very, very big, you know, role, especially when you're in a pack that's getting beaten every week. So we need a bit of experience. As a young lad, you're going to benefit. I think for me, like you say, having a couple of games off, seeing what Gayle does, being around him at training, I don't think there's anything wrong with having that conversation, you know, and seeing what happened from there.
I just don't get it. But I don't think there's that much we can say. Hull played well.
Got to give credit to Hull. They've got a good couple of back consecutive wins now, haven't they?
But they, they won just before the international break.
Huddersfield
beat Wigan. And now, I don't want to be funny, but we talked about that with West Tigers. If you're a struggling team, you want to play the West. Hull FC, I'm buzzing that they've got Wakefield that week, because... It's another game. It's going to be 3-3, and suddenly you've got some momentum.
Yeah.
They always show the graphic of the last five games, and if you see 3-5, you're probably thinking you're not in too bad of a position.
And it's consecutive, isn't it?
Yeah.
And so that's a big thing as well, if you can do it week on week. But I'm happy because, again, it's been... One, you want a good competitive team, like I always say, but two as well, I think Tony Smith needs this, because a lot of people are putting Tony Smith under pressure. He's a good coach, and when he speaks, I think he says a lot of the right things a lot of the time. So I'm happy he's getting some wins now. He'll probably start to get some recognition he deserves, and that's what they need. So a good win for Hull.
Yeah, we're gonna move on from that over to Huddersfield, Lee.
boy, Lewis, oh boy.
You keep backing them because you think they're going to come good. Surely that must be changing at some point because Lee played Huddersfield off the park.
Well, I thought about this. So, yes, you are. I keep backing them wrongly because I think they've got to come good. They've got too many players not to. However, we said the same thing about Wellington last season and look what happened there. So I think now, as much as I kind of hope they do well and I kind of back them and I think they're going to win, and can I see them? I don't think they're going to lose every single game now for the rest of this season, but they are in a poor run of form at the minute. I think, like we discussed the other week, Watson's under pressure. He still doesn't know his best 1-30. He's not getting things right. And I think this is a tricky period because Watson, really, he's never even been in this position before, has he?
No.
He's always kind of, you know, at Salford he had success, he overachieved. Huddersfield last year, they played well, people were backing him. They got to a Challenge Cup final, okay, they missed out on the literally, you know, bounced the ball off a kick for Wigan to win it, for Marshall to go over and score. So this is probably the first time now in his career where he's under a bit of pressure and he's struggled. And he's not used to finding himself in this position. So it's going to be interesting to see how he handles it, I think.
So there was a couple of things that was noted. More stats-wise, we look at Lee's back three, Hardacre, Briscoe, back five, sorry. Hardacre, Briscoe, Latelli, Reynolds and Charnley. Hardacre made 155 metres, Briscoe 160, Ricky Latelli 194, Charnley and Reynolds just touching around 100. You take that across to Huddersfield's back five, and Eason Masters has run 115 metres, Naguama 166. Two really poor metre making from Connor with 48, Jake Bibby 32 metres. The other winger was Leroy Cudjoe, who actually made an awful lot of metres, another 183. But one of the things that really, really worried me was Tui Lulahia made 253 metres, making 30 carries, putting an awful lot of pressure on one player when you've got the likes of Jake Connor, you've got the likes of these strike centres, and they're all being used to set up the play.
I was going to bring up Tui Lulahia as well, but for a different reason. Joe Mellor's try. Have you seen that? it was described in the Huddersfield match report as a one-on-one ball steal by Joe Mellor on Lulahia, who scored, not under the post, but scored untouched. What actually happened was they put a big kick in Lee. Lulahia picks it up, starts running it back, and with nobody anywhere near him, completely untouched, spills the ball. No one was even tackling him. He just dropped the ball forward. Mellor picks it up and falls over, and it's a try. So that is the result, because it was towards the end, of what you've just talked about, 30 carries, 200 and something metres.
Much work.
Being tackled 30 times, that's why he dropped that ball.
And I'm looking at the likes of the forwards. Hill made 9 carries, McQueen made 9, Luke Yates 11, Matty English 7. Harry Rushton made 15, ex-Wiganer. Ikahi 4, sorry, made 8. Adam O'Brien 5, Oliver Wilson 7. Sam Hewitt, 6. Kieran Rush, made 20.
Young halfback.
There's not a lot of metres made by that forward line.
You expect four to be taking more carries than that. The fact that some of them are in, well, most of them are in single figures there for the forwards, aren't they?
And we are all for bigging up your back five coming in.
It's one of our favourite things to do, how good your back five are for taking carries.
But for me, when you take that first tackle, usually your fullback gets tackled. You go a winger, a centre, and then tackle four, tackle five. One of your props, maybe a second rower, has got to make them metres, and they're not doing it. They're just not doing it. And if they're not doing that, you're then asking Lulla here to take him in. These backs, who you then need to get your try scoring in, it just doesn't seem like the balance is right whatsoever. It's far too much work consistently.
Some credit to Lee. Lee Leopards,
they
deserve some credit. They've looked really good this year. Charnley, 2 tries again. Top scorer. And he's showing no signs of slowing down. They've beaten all the teams from Yorkshire. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. That's true, yeah.
So they've beaten every team from Yorkshire. Maybe they'll change the name again at the end of this year to the Lee Yorkshire Rippers.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine that.
How long have you been planning that one?
I I don't even plan.
I'd love to see Derek Beaumont's blazer if they do. The new shirt he comes out with the Lee Yorkshire Rippers. That'd be a sight to see.
Oh, definitely.
For me, just a leopard print, but blood stains.
Brilliant.
Neck.
Oh, you're still doing things right. You've got Wakefield in the Cup this week. You'd fancy him there. Imagine saying at the start of the year, quarterfinals at Cup.
Yeah.
Top six.
Yeah.
Probably the in-form team, if you're going off wins.
Lee are the in-form team. They won five in a row.
The team you don't want to play at the minute. I have to say so. Again, no, the team, I don't think Wakefield are going to... Is it Wakefield said they've got in the Cup? So yeah, Wakefield are going to dread playing Lee, and I'm sure I don't... Well, we play them, don't we? It's been... That's been moved to Channel 4
until next month.
That'll be an interesting game, and that comes around if they keep this form going. But I know that's been moving over to Channel 4. But yeah, they're a good team at the minute, and yeah, they're going to be tricky customers.
Absolutely.
Playing with confidence. And I think that they're adamant that they deserve to be in the top six.
Oh, they do. And you know what, as well? They're not even the newly promoted team that are hard to beat. That's not them. They're beating teams handily.
Yeah,
they're out playing teams.
They're not winning games by 4 points.
They're not grinding out results. They're actually battering teams, and they're actually scoring a lot of points. And for a promoted, newly promoted team, they're very entertaining. Your job when you get promoted isn't to be entertaining; it's to stay up.
Be pragmatic.
But they are really, really entertaining team. They're good to watch.
Very much.
They've got some excellent players. I love that shift play they do that gets Charlie in every time. Yep. Absolutely adore that play they do right to left.
Now, we'll move over to the Menderhall's jungle. Castleford losing by 46 points to 22. They were 34 points to 6 down at half-time. A terrible start. They've actually won the second half. But when you're behind by 28 points the second half, at the start of the second half, what chances do you give yourself? You're not giving yourself a chance to be in the game.
Some of those tries that they conceded were just so easy. They were just so soft. You're right. I think especially of like one of the Adam Kieran ones, the Tomkins one, like Desiree just ran through and nobody even tried to stop him. Garcia was the same. Like there were just a lot of tries where these Catalan players, they're not being made to work for the try, and the cast players are. So you're shooting yourselves in your foot there with just a bit of soft defence, and you could see the fans behind that goal that the Castellan were attacking in the first half, like the home end. They were just like apathetic at the end of it. They weren't even bothered. It was just like, oh, here comes another try. They come forward again. Oh, another missed tackle. Yeah. Another try. It's like you just don't care anymore.
It's such a difficult place to be in.
It's just soft.
They'll be disappointed as well because they've scored 22 points. That is enough to win you a rugby league game.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Or to be competitive.
Yeah, definitely. It's enough to win or be competitive. And the fact that you've conceded over 30 points in the half is...
Let's say they lose to Catalan maybe like 26, 22.
30 points to 22.
There's no hardship in that.
They're a good team, Catalan.
But being 34-6 down at half-time is embarrassing.
And no question, Catalan eased it a bit.
Yeah.
Definitely.
But I watched and I just got... They put a shift in for half a game. One half.
When Catalan has got the queue on the rack a bit as well.
Yeah. But I look at the Wigan game when we played them, though. Was it round four? 6-6 at half-time. They put a real shift in the second half. They just didn't turn up.
6-0, that was.
6-0, sorry. They don't seem to be able to put more than a 40-minute performance together, and that's not good enough. It's just not consistently.
No, you've got to be. If you want to be competitive, you've got to be competitive over 18 minutes. And again, Andy, I'll still be disappointed with that. So,
but Catalans, probably very good in the first half, probably eased off in the second. I think that's fair to say.
Mm.
But they should be happy, really.
It's a game they've expected to win, and you'd expect Catalans to win, but you've got to go there and get the 2 points and do it. So yeah, they'll go away and they'll look to the Cup next week.
Yeah. So we'll move on. The last game on Friday. Only four on Friday this week. I should have mentioned that earlier on, because you know.
It's a pet hate.
Massively. Warrington played Hull KR at the Halliwell Jones. They won 21 points to 14. Try scorers for Warrington were Matty Ashton, Ben Curry and Josh Maguire.
Well, did he score Josh Maguire?
Well, they've awarded it him.
It was close. It was very close. I think there was three Warrington players and three Hull KR players all touched it down at the same time. Maybe Maguire just shouted the loudest and that's why they give it to him, but
yeah,
go on.
But then try scorers for Hull KR were Kane Lynette, Ethan Ryan. Williams hit a drop goal.
Yeah.
I think I backed Hull KR. With the run of games that Hull KR have had, the wins that they've had, losing a game by 7 points to Warrington isn't the end of the world.
It's not, but it's a big win for Warrington.
It's a big win for Warrington.
I agree.
I think it's a bigger win for Warrington than it is a loss for Hull KR, if that makes sense.
It's more important to Warrington's season than it is to Hull KR.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
Another interesting thing of, they obviously started Diolis at fullback again.
Don't change the winning team. Did
Dufty not play?
Dufty play off the bench.
Off the bench.
Bit of a surprise. I agree with the not changing a winning team, but 4 weeks ago he was going to win Man of Steel according to Warrington fans, well, or Williams, and then suddenly... Yeah, it's a bad couple of games, and
this can't be right, because are you looking at the Super League website? Because it's got Joe Bullock at scrum half.
I haven't noticed that.
My pet hate is the Super League website. I'm saying that because I just thought then, why has it got Matoti on the right wing and Matty Ashton on the left centre? And then I realised George Williams was on the left wing and Joe Bullock was at scrum half. And I know Joe Bullock, you know, we like.
Why has done very well? Very well to win that
for them
game.
To win that game
with Joe Bullock at scrum half.
With Joe Bullock at scrum half and Danny Walker at prop.
He could do it. You know he can.
I think either way, we'll try and get some clarity on what the teams were now, but essentially it's still a big win for Warrington.
Thewlis played. I think he probably played on the wing, but Thewlis played and. The Warrington fans were crying out for Thewlis to play, well, to get back from his injury and to play well.
No, and, I was right, sorry.
So who played?
Thewlis played full-back, Russell and Ashton.
Ah, so it's Russell that's missing.
We're on the wings, and Dufty was off the bench.
So Matty Russell doesn't exist, and Leon Hayes, I presume, was the 18th man.
Let me just check.
Was named on the bench, according
to... No, Lucas Green was the 18th man.
So Leon Hayes...
Hayes isn't on the...
He's just got a promotion, according to the Super League website. He made his debut.
Can't even get our own app right.
No, it's so stupid, this website. He's still got Joe Bullock in a Wigan shirt from 2018, by the way.
but going back onto that, I think Wire, be happy with a win. Okay, I won't be that disappointed with the loss. They'll be disappointed, and I expect them to be. But in all points given, I think that is a fair result. Both teams will be happy. KR will be happy to go back and fix a few things.
Okay, I'll look to bounce back this week.
They'll look to bounce back. Yeah. But going there and losing to Wire doesn't matter what form you're in. That's a possibility. So
they made it close, and we thought it was going to be a close game.
Yeah, they were
literally, you know, when the drop goal's involved, it's going to be, you know, a close game. And did you say they were winning them?
Winning at half time, yeah. So it was 12-0, and then it was 12-6 at half time.
Right, okay, so
they just didn't come out the second half, they only got 2 points.
Again, there's a thing called KR, and I'm sure it would. You just don't want to, like Matty said, that you'd be ready to back to put the wrongs to right next week and bounce back. You don't want to just build up a couple of losses, but I can't see OKR doing that because they've had a really good season, and I think they will. They'll finish it strong.
So then finally, the last game was on Channel 4 this week, Saints versus Salford. Saints winning 26 points to 12. Half time, they were losing 12 points to 6. They've come out 20 unanswered points. Mm.
Another big win, this, I think.
Yeah,
you said the Wire one was a big win. I think this was a big win for Saints as well.
The one thing I want to add to it was it was a bad 10-15 minutes by Salford. It just seemed like everything unravelled, and they just lost the plot, really. Saints capitalised, Saints did what Saints do, but I think it's as much down to Salford having a bad 10-15 minutes and Saints doing what they can do at the right times. Bit of trouble, really, from Salford.
Well, before that, they were getting themselves in trouble on their own goal line by that stupid pass, He tried to pass it to Burgess on his own try line, and I know Burgess is tall, but he's not that tall. And it went straight over his head, and was it Lomax that caught it and scored? I think it was Lomax where he just fell over.
That's what I mean, things like that.
Try. Just shoot yourself in the foot, don't you?
When you look at when Saints scored, they scored 10 minutes before half-time to make it 12-6.
Yeah, that was a good offload, that.
Sirenen scored 2 minutes after half-time. Lomax then scored 5 minutes after half-time. Makinson scored at 49 minutes, and Joe Batchelor scored on the 53rd, so they scored 4 tries within 30 minutes of the second half. That's a capitulation. That's just
momentum going, and then the game stayed 26-12 for the next 27 minutes. So they got back into the game, Salford. But I just think that 10 minutes has just killed them. You can't do that to Saints.
Wow, 209 metres for Alex Walmsley. 209 from prop. Mm. Next highest was 112 for Sirin, and so almost 100 more than your next highest. And I think that was only on... it was 25 carries, I think.
Yeah.
25 carries for 209 metres. So that's incredible work from a prop forward, really, isn't it?
But it's been a bit of an issue with Salford this week, haven't they? They've come out and said about we might have to sell some of our stars if we don't get the funding. They've obviously gone to a public, a fan-owned club, haven't they?
Mm-hmm.
And then there was rumours of a bid being made for one of the star players. Doesn't name who that star player was.
But it said it wasn't Brodie Croft.
And then suddenly, the leader of, I don't know what the correct terminology is, has come out and said, I think his words were, we may have to lose star players if we want to run financially viable club. That's not a great thing to be hearing after it's only just started.
No, it's upsetting really to think that we could have a club in trouble soon, especially a club that is on the up. That you can see as Salford Red Devils.
They should be going step to step here. They should be really putting the foot down now.
Well, on the field, they've been more and more successful, and we praised them a couple of weeks ago, didn't we, for that and for their improvement on the field. And you don't want something off the pitch to ruin that. I'm just desperate for that not to happen.
No, yeah, it'd be a shame if that was to happen. So is it investors the hoping they get like funding or investors?
It's like a fan. It's like a fan investment.
Sure, isn't it,
fan investment scheme, and
right,
you buy into it, and they're saying like if not enough of our fans buy into it, and we don't have the funding we need, we don't hit our fundraising targets. It's like an under 9s team, this, isn't it? But then we'll have to sell some of our star players, which we didn't have to do last year.
Right,
okay. Yeah,
that'll be a shame.
It's not a good position to be in, is it?
No, hopefully not. Yourself. And again, media reports like that, you don't want it as your player, a coach involved with Salford, you want that hanging over your head where you know that could be a possibility.
Yeah.
It's not a good place to be in. So hopefully that gets sorted soon, because like you said, we'd hate to see any of our clubs in Super League suffer any difficulty.
Okay, we're going to take a quick break and we'll come back with a little bit of NRL news. Thank you. So this week it was round 11 in the NRL. Quite a few big games. The Melbourne Storm started off the week playing against Brisbane at Amy Park. The Storm came out 24 points to 16. The big talking point in this game, though, was Carrigan's yellow card. Got done for a crusher tackle. Not a crusher tackle, sorry.
A hip drop. They're all the rage.
Yeah, a hip drop tackle. He argued with the ref saying that it wasn't given at the time. And that he hadn't performed a hip drop tackle.
The match review panel the day after agreed with him. So
yeah,
it wasn't actually a hip
drop. They've overturned
panel.
It, so he's now not been banned for Origin.
But the weird thing is, right, that they gave him a sin bin on Thursday, and then on Friday they said it was wrong, and they put that video out that we shared onto the Twitter about what a hip drop is. And then there was someone Saturday morning, I think there was one by the Eels, because I was watching the Raiders, the Eels. There was one by the Eels that didn't get punished. Mm. It was just a penalty and put on report, or maybe it was just even put on report. And they were saying, if you're Patrick Carrigan now and you've been sin-binned, and while you're in the sin-bin...
potentially cost your team.
Yeah, while you're in the sin-bin, the other team scored, and they only won by one try, then you're going to be fuming, aren't you?
Mm.
I think they scored the penalty from it, and then they scored a try, so they're getting 8 points. It was just ridiculous, really.
Do you think they're looking for him too much now? Because it's been a big talking point, and it's kind of...
They're overcorrected.
It's one of those, it's just a mistake off the ref.
They've overcorrected, I think. And I saw NRL 360 last night, and Jai Arrow was on there talking about exactly what you said, Lewis. The first week this was brought up, the hip drops, when it was about, I think it was about Morgan Knowles, just trying to tackle somebody. And you're tired forward, and they've beaten you with a bit of footwork or whatever, and you're just trying to get them down to the ground, and you just use your body weight to try and do that.
The problem is, though, you can't do that. The risk is too high.
No, but I don't think they're doing it on purpose. I think it's just a case of you're trying to tackle someone, you've got hold of them, and the momentum's taking you off your feet.
But my issue with that argument is that if you are dropping your weight and they're taking you with you, Your feet can't come out in front of you. They're almost sitting down and dropping the backside on the floor.
Yeah, but Carrigan didn't do that.
Carrigan doesn't. He slips, doesn't he? And he's falling off. And it's actually almost his chest slashes, like, midriff that lands on his legs.
And I think there was... it might have been Luke Keary was talking about... they were talking about cannonball tackles, you know, and saying, oh, you can't cannonball now. So they're looking for anything below the knee. So everyone's starting to try and tackle on the hips. And when you tackle on somebody's hips, it automatically drops down and you end up with a hip drop. So he was saying, like, this cannonball tackle, which there was a nasty one, I think, in the Eels game that I watched. These cannonball tackles where they're attacking the knee joints, they tried to stamp that out. They tried to stamp out the chicken wing, and Talis was on there saying, like, well, there'll be another one soon. There'll always be another one, because if you outlaw one, by accident, another one starts coming through. So this cannonball that they tried to outlaw, or the crusher, the cannonball, the chicken wing, then the cannonball turns into the hip drop because you have to tackle them higher. That's what Talis was saying, and, like, Luke Keary.
I just think, for me, when there's two... The ones that are bad for me are when there's two men holding someone up.
The Mike Cooper one, yeah.
Yeah. At that point, if you want to get into the floor, you've got to drop in control, clamp the legs, and take him to the ground. You can't use your weight. You can't attack the joint. You're in control of that. But going back onto the game, a big win for Melbourne. They seem to have a bit of a thing over the Broncos. I think it's 8 out of the last 10 they've beat the Broncos. Now, they're going to be without Adam Reynolds, who failed his HIA, stretched it off. They missed for 60 minutes. They'll be disappointed, but I think that's a good sign for Melbourne that they've got a win back.
Yeah, they've had a good... They seem a bit hit and miss at the minute, Melbourne, don't they? Where they're kind of...
I think they're in a transition, aren't they?
Yeah, they're winning some games, losing some others, you know, but... I think they'll, again, they'll be up there thereabouts when the season comes to an end.
Top eight.
Because I know Brisbane's been struggling with a couple of injuries recently, haven't they? I know they had a couple of injuries when they played Souths a couple of weeks back, and then Reynolds has gone off failing his HIA, so they'll be wanting to get the strongest team back out there, because I think when they've got the strongest team back out there, they're sad if they're trying to win the comp.
I think they're probably the two best teams in the comp, really.
Yeah, well, they're awfully fit.
Who's that?
Broncos and Rabbits.
Oh, yeah, the Rabbits, yeah. I thought you were right at the Storm then, yeah.
When they're both fully fit.
We'll talk about both. Rabbits in a bit.
Yeah. But then we'll move on. The Warriors beat the Bulldogs 24-12. Bit of a professional performance
from the Warriors. I'm impressed with the Warriors again. I'm impressed with Aiden Fanua-Blake. He's had 5 tries now. That's when he's Brian Toto, Jordan Rapana, and he's a prop. So he's playing half the minutes, and he's not a winger, and he's not marked by wingers, Lewis.
Yeah, very true. Mm.
He's in the middle of the park. So I'm really impressed with the Warriors. Again, top 8 challengers.
Yeah, I think it's a professional performance. The Bulldogs were missing players. They moved a few people around. There's talks of would Ado Carr play because he was coming back and trying to get... All the media's around the Bulldogs, and they've just gone out, done a performance, moved on. Now they get a bye, don't they, in the Indigenous round, which I feel is like a massive missed chance by the NRL.
I know. The Indigenous round is such a celebration of heritage, and there's always the Indigenous flag up against with the Maori flag when you talk about Indigenous round, and for New Zealand Warriors not to be playing.
It feels criminal.
The team that represents the entire New Zealand nation and all those Maori people. I know there are Maori players playing on other teams, but for them not to be able to represent their heritage on Indigenous round, it just seems like a shame to me. And you don't want anyone to miss out. Like, we didn't want the Knights to miss out on Magic last time. It's just, there needs to be an even number of teams, really. And we might talk a bit more about that later, because there is going to be an 18th team next year. We're just working out who it's going to be.
Now, massive result on the Friday late kickoff.
Yeah.
Penrith versus the Roosters. Penrith winning 48 points to 4. Where is it going wrong for the Roosters?
They've got problems, haven't they?
They've got some serious problems. They can't seem to hold teams down to low scores. They can't seem to get a consistent amount of points.
They can't score points. I think that's the big thing that we've seen the last couple of days. They can't score points.
But they dropped Walker and brought in Manu at the halves and whatever. But they're not getting them into the game. The Roosters at the best play fast and flat.
They get people. They get Tedesco with the ball at the line. They get Manu with the ball in his hand near the line, beating people. They look tired in defence. Big Jared, Matt Lodge, they were missing tackles early on.
They made a lot of mistakes that are uncharacteristic for some great players. Like, and they give... And Nat Butcher had to make 60 tackles again, which I know we praised him a couple of weeks ago for making 50 off.
He can't keep doing it.
But he can't keep doing it. They let Isaiah Yeo run 216 metres. Mm. It was just procession, really, for Penrith. The completion rate for the Roosters... They had 35 sets, they completed 24. That's 68%.
It's just not good enough.
And Penrith were at 41 out of 46. They seem trying to
fix it. They don't know what the solution is, don't they? The Roosters, they've tried. Walker's gone, Manu's moved to six. I don't think that's worked. I said a couple of weeks ago, I didn't know if he was a six and it's going to work. I don't think it is doing. Brandon Smith at nine for him seems to be a bit out of character. We're not seeing
when
he was at Melbourne.
Look at the types of players they've got. Tedesco, look through the spine. Tedesco, Kieran, Manu, Smith, Radley. The five very different players. Mm. There's not one where you look at them and go, that's the way they're going to play.
Well, it should be... Tedesco should be that one, really.
Yeah.
And there was no... Well, Smith was starting on the bench this time. Jake Turpin started. But, I mean, that's by the by, really. Brandon Smith is the...
He's the spine. He's the one they're paying $800,000 for.
Yeah.
He's the main one.
You think some pressure on to Robbo, Trent Robinson?
In terms of his job?
Yeah.
I think he's had it long enough that...
He's safe.
He's won enough. He's got enough credit in the bank.
He's safe. Mm.
Now, if they were outside the eight and we were talking wooden spoon candidates, that's a different question.
Well, there's two wooden spoon candidates and they're not the Roosters, so...
But as it stands, I think either one of them team, the Roosters, the facility to get rid of Robinson... Trent Robinson. I think it'd be a stupid move. I've not heard any rumours of it.
No, I haven't either. I'm just saying.
I don't think he's in danger.
This is the sort of performance that starts those rumours usually.
Yeah, I just think he's got enough credit in the bank.
I'd agree, but it's disappointing, isn't it? Because used to the Roosters being up there and competing, so to see him like this, you hope they find an answer soon so they can get back to where they were, but it seems like they're a bit... I don't know if Robinson's got the answers. I don't know if he's still looking for it. I don't know because, like you said, the squad's there. The squad's good. It's got talent throughout, isn't it? So
that's the thing to keep thinking. If they make the playoffs, they can still win it. They can win it from eighth.
Yeah.
Because Tedesco, Manu, Kiri, Smith,
Radley,
and then you go into the backs, Tupu, Suwalii, who's the other centre? I forgot the name of the other centre. They've got quality all over the pitch. They've just got enough to beat you and it matters. They've just got to get there and they've got to find some form before then.
You mean Jackson Paulo and Billy Smith on that left-hand side?
Was it not...
Who played on Friday, Billy Smith.
No, it's not who I thought it was. You know what I mean, though? I just think they've got enough depth in them and ability and enough good quality players that they can fix it when it matters. But
you hope so. Good win for Penrith, though, back to... Yeah. They've had a bit of a shaky
respect start to this Penrith. Season. They've put three good wins together now, Penrith. We've got to give them some respect.
Yeah, you've got to hopefully get them back.
Can't believe we've been talking about that when you've got... they've won it back-to-back, but they've not been the best, and some people have started to write them off, really.
No, from where they've set their standards, again, over the last couple of years, they've been below that. So, But again, results like this and performances like this is what kind of... gets them back to where they need to be and with still some respect back in them.
Now, one team in Sydney that are struggling to one that are just doing everything right. Rabbitohs win 20-0 against the West Tigers. West look very one-dimensional. They've gone to play in that straight attacking style, keeping it simple and letting Api Korosau run the game.
Which we were saying they should
do. Which we were saying they were doing.
But that wouldn't work against the Rabbitohs.
But suddenly they play the Rabbitohs and like... Campbell Graham, he's defending almost 20-25 metres in field because he's just saying, go on, try and beat us on the outside if you want to do it. They just knew they were too good.
Mm.
They're defending hard. And every time they get the ball on their own line at the start of a set, they're rolling downfield. Them forwards are making ridiculous metres. You can't stop them at the moment.
The stats for this game are really, really close. Every stat, apart from South Sydney made 6 line breaks to 1. Everything else was really close, so I think it was just that. They had that killer instinct to just cut the Tigers open at home.
That class and quality, yeah, just to get points when it matters. Yeah,
exactly. And Luttrell was mic'd up for this game, and a few of his teammates have been getting him some stick on Twitter, and Arrow kept that up yesterday on NRL 360, saying like he was a lot chattier than usual and they were trying to work out why. Obviously, he was playing up with the mic he had on. But it was actually quite interesting viewing, because he scored the try where he crashed over, where he called for it early. And he also had a great offload from Campbell Graham that he put Milne over, where he probably could have scored himself, Mitchell. Mm. But I think Mitchell at the minute, he's an X factor. We spoke about him last week, being probably the biggest superstar in the game. Absolute X factor. Every time he touches ball, you have to watch closer because he might do absolutely anything.
Well, in Origin, he's probably going to play centre. Yeah. I think they have to give him just freedom to go and play. You see something, you're not liking what you're seeing on your side, drift, go and do whatever, go and get your hand on the balls, because as soon as he calls for it, you have to give Mitchell the ball and let him run over people, let him dominate the game, because he is that good.
Yeah, well, you use him as in when if he wants ball early, you give him ball early. If you want to take him to the line and put it flat, you listen
that's
to him.
What I mean, though, if he's playing that left centre, he's sort of a bit tied up. You've got to give him, when you get there...
It was his magic that opened the game. This was 8-0, this game, with 10 minutes left.
I just think, go on, Luttrell, go and do what you want.
He set up a try for Milne and he scored himself. Mm. Like, game over. Shut the door on the West Tigers himself.
Now, I'm going to move on. The Cowboys versus St. George. Cowboys winning 42-22, but the big news from this, Coach Griffin sacked by the Dragons.
Yeah, Coach Griffin, Anthony Griffin, he was under pressure for a long time, sitting at the bottom of the ladder, 2 wins all year.
It felt inevitable.
It did. It did. They were really poor in this game. They let 7 tries in. Mm. They let, for some reason, Valentine Holmes get a 2-point drop goal. Don't know why
I didn't notice that.
No, that was just before half time to make it 24-6.
Oh, yes, sorry, yeah.
And then in the second half, they let 3 more tries in. It was just like a procession at some points. And yes, they scored 4 tries. And like you were saying before, Lewis, about Castleford, they scored 22 points, they scored 4 tries, but they still were nowhere near a win. This is exactly like that Catalan Cas game. They scored 22. And yet they still lost by 20 points. They still lost easily.
Yeah.
Because the defence was not... I'm
telling you, the defence is not good enough. It's not the
defence was not good enough at all.
I don't think a coach is going to fix this. Ben Hunt being the professional, the model professional that he is.
Yeah, game he 300 was it for Ben Hunt?
Yeah, tried to back his coach and tried to support him. He's done everything that he can. It's just some things I don't like that I'm hearing about the Dragons. What was it from Jack Bird? Lost 7-7 and then says, oh, the fans just need to back us.
Yeah, blaming the fans.
And I'm going, you can't do that. Get a win and they'll back you.
They don't seem to have thingy for me, St. George. Maybe they, again, I know I don't. I'm probably not as big into the NRL as you two are, so correct me if I'm wrong, but the squad doesn't seem studied talent. I know they've got Ben Hunt, they've got Zach Lomax, who I think is a good centre.
Been dropped to reserve, Chris.
Well, there you go. I mean, I've read him from what I've seen of him. Whether he's having his best season or not this season, I don't. Obviously, the coach has dropped him for a reason. But, I mean, apart from that, there's no real big... Is there any
I know
real
what you mean, Lewis. I know what you mean, because when I think about the Tigers, yes, they've been awful for years, but they've attracted John Bateman. They've attracted Api Corriso, Papali'i, Offahingawi. They've attracted big names, Charlie Staines. Yeah. The Bulldogs... They attracted Matt Burton, Jacob Carras,
Ado Carr.
They've attracted these big names, Reid Morney. The Dragons team... They've got Kikau. Kikau now, he's just out injured for a while. But you think about the Dragons, and you look down that list and you think, there's nobody really done anything in their careers apart from Ben Hunt, really. I might be wrong, missing one of the forwards out. I'm very sorry if I do that. But
Jack Bird's had a bit of a career.
Yeah, there's maybe a couple of like journeyman NRL players, but you're right, there's no superstars in there apart from Ben Hunt, who is one man and towards the end of his career, and like, Lomax, who they've dropped.
I just think we always say the game's not played on paper, but if you put... St George's list of players down, you max two team sheets up every week. I wonder how many times you'll think St George got a chance, are you going to look on paper and say they're too strong?
I don't think you ever would. I think they, on paper, they have the weakest squad in the league. I think it's a good point you make. And I think we always talk in this country about how Wakefield's squad perhaps isn't as good as some of our other squads, and how Castleford's squad isn't the best and whatever. But in the NRL, you don't tend to think of it like that. You think even the bad teams have got star players.
Yeah.
Lots of star players. Even the bad teams.
There's a couple coming through. I like the fullback. Is it Sloan? I think he's a
Tyrell Sloan, yeah.
Yeah, I think he's going to be a real talent. But there's talks that he's going to be off.
Well, I don't know why he wouldn't be.
They had Jason Saab and let him go to Manly. These talents that they brought through over the last 4 or 5 years, they've let go. They've not kept.
Mm.
It's just not going to develop a team.
No.
Which is a shame, really, because it's historically quite a bit of a hotbed for generating talent, the St George area. Wollongong, Jackson Hastings is from the Morris brothers.
Yeah.
What was that fella called who played for Toronto for a long time? Blake.
Ashton Sims is from.
Yes.
Started off at
Lots of good players come through that system. Mm-hmm. And so it's a shame, really, to see them changing the coach again and not like, struggling with the team.
In my opinion, you can't keep changing the coach. Eventually, you've got to look at the playing squad.
Well, it's pretty much a very similar squad to what Murray had, Paul McGregor, the previous coach, who they sacked. And that was only less than 18 months ago.
Who's going to touch this now? They're talking about the young lad, Jason Riles.
Roosters.
The Roosters assistant was taught that he was going to get Bellamy's job, who's decided to go again in 2024. If you're a young lad, why would you touch this?
Well, you're struggling.
Look at what happens like with Trent Barrett. He took on the Bulldogs job himself, and he wasn't ready. And he probably might not get a coaching job again, especially as the top dog.
Mm-hmm.
So then you look and you go, it's took Gus Gould going in and bringing in Seraldo, someone who's been in the game for 20, 25 years.
And they've not only spent a lot of cash, but... Yeah. Because all these teams have got a lot of cash to spend, they've also attracted the big money players. Because you're not telling me, if Kikau's leaving Penrith and he's going for money, that the Tigers weren't interested.
St George weren't interested.
Canterbury weren't interested. Mm. You know, that all those teams would have been sniffing around him, all those ones with cap space.
Yeah. Right. Last three games, we're going to fly through them. A close encounter in the nation's capital. The Raiders versus Parramatta. Raiders winning 26 points to 18. It was 8-8 at half time.
Yeah.
But a 10 minute spell just after half time sort of took the game away from the Eels, took it to 20 points to 8. And every time the Eels scored, the Raiders got a bit of a jump back away.
The Raiders were fantastic.
Yeah.
Hudson Young was fantastic again. He's got to get a shout in for Origin for the Blues for me. Hudson Young was absolutely fantastic. Matt Tim McCaw again. I said last week how much I rate him as a young centre. Brilliant game again. Horsburgh got simbined, and the Eels scored during that time while he was off.
He has to play Origin, big red.
Well, when he come back on, he made a big difference, because actually that 10 minutes that he had sat down, because he was a bit fiery, he did give somebody a bit of a 1-inch punch.
Mm.
That 10 minutes he had where he was sat down, he come back on and he was like a man possessed for the rest of the game. And he was clever, he was clean, but he was fiery. And I think that's the Horsburgh that you need if you're going to get him to play Origin.
I don't think he can play 80 minutes. I think you just need to spell him at the right time.
Just get him simbin. Yeah. He only play 70.
I think big win for Canberra this, because they've had, I know, Matt, you said before that you thought it was going to come good because they played a lot of the stronger teams to start with, but you could have seen Power, tough team, three customers.
I was just about to say, the Eels, you should be looking at and saying, oh, well, they're not in the top eight. They're actually in 14th. But they've not lost any games by loads. Lost 2 points to the Titans, 10 to the Brisbane, lost by 8 to the Roosters, lost by 4 to the Sea Eagles.
No Moses, though. Mitchell Moses in this game. Jake Arthur played the coach's son, who actually touched Jay Field's job. That's why we ended up with Jay Field, because that was his job as like the backup halfback for the Eels.
So out of the 7 games they've lost, they've only lost 6 of them by less than 8 points.
Mm.
That must be really one demoralising as an Eels fan. But they're not a million miles away. They could turn it around.
Yeah, what you're saying about the Raiders, Lewis, was right about them them coming good because they played all the toughest teams at the beginning.
Yeah.
They're going up that table.
Yeah. Now we'll move on. The Knights versus the Gold Coast.
Yeah.
Dom Young bagging a brace, but the main man, he stayed back and did extra training when the rest of the Knights went away or were busy over Magic Weekend. Ponga had an unbelievable game. And any question about whether he'd be fit to play in Origin or whatever, I think it's been answered after that. I think
it's a tough choice, isn't it, for Billy Slater?
Whether I'm not saying he plays full back. He might take the number 14.
Mm.
But he has to play.
Well, he was the best player on that field in that game, wasn't he?
Oh,
by a country mile.
Yes,
so.
Yes. Definitely.
I don't think there's another player in the league. If you asked me to pick an NRL player to beat someone one-on-one, I'm picking Ponga. I think his left foot, right foot step, his ability to go from 0 to 100.
Mm.
I think you would argue he's definitely in the top three.
It's Walsh, it's Mitchell, and it's Ponga.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's those three.
And two of them are definitely playing Origin.
Well, yes.
It's whether Walsh or Ponga makes the third job.
David Fifita went 80 metres and scored a try, by the way.
Yeah.
That's a back row forward who is a big, big unit.
Sharp, wasn't he? I know he moves,
but that's still a back row forward, making 80 metres to score. The Titans, this is interesting. They missed the last two kicks, Tanner Boyd, especially the one right near the end. That means they've now scored 26 points five games in a row.
I'd have dropped to 1 point, mate.
How ridiculous is that? No, I think they want to score 26 points every time. I think they're aiming for it.
If you score 26 points in most games, you should be.
And they've won a few of them. That last kick was easy. Well, it wasn't easy, but it wasn't a difficult kick. He could have definitely got that, but he just knew the record was at stake.
missed it on purpose for it to get to 26.
Well, they were so far behind. They were 20 behind. He wasn't going to win. So, yeah, just miss it to keep the 26.
Right.
It's a talking point.
Last game. Cronulla versus Manly. Cronulla winning 20 points to 14. A close game. A close fought game.
Yeah.
I
watched this one. I was up to watch this one on Sunday. A friend of mine was picking me up at 9 o'clock. Going somewhere, so I just got the last bit of this game just before we left. It was a fantastic game.
And Manly, they just can't seem to get things right for 80 minutes. Cronulla will be happy that they've got a win.
Especially after Magic getting hammered by the Dolphins.
Hammered by the Dolphins.
They need a bounce back.
Cronulla 100% be right there.
But I think Cronulla will be top 8. Argue that we could get top 4 if they sort a few things out. Be interesting to see how they play if Hines does get picked in Origin.
I think he will
do. Oh, Hines is getting picked for Origin.
I think Nicky will do.
Hines is getting picked at 14 for Origin, I think. I think Jerome Luai will keep the shirt. And I think they will play with Hines off the bench rather than Appy. I think Cook will start and Hines on the bench. But this is for a podcast in a few weeks, I think.
Yeah. Right. That's the NRL. We're going to come back after a quick break and we're going to talk a little bit of news. Quick fire predictions and then we'll sign off.
Yeah, Dolphins on the bye.
Dolphins on the bye. So, in some good news for Wigan, the female team, they played the group stages of the Nines comp. They came top of that with 3 wins. I think all 3 were quite convincing wins.
Top of their group, yeah.
Winning like 26 points to 10 or very, very close like that, which is a real, really good thing. And we both said that we would, I'd like to see a Nines competition in the men's. I think it's a great format and something that can get really excited about. But it's great to see that the women have got it at the moment and hopefully that can go from strength to strength. The final's set to be in a couple of weeks, I think it is.
Yeah, there's quite a few groups and all the winners are going through to
them. Yeah, I think there's, what's the word?
Like a finals day type.
Yeah, thing. Finals day. I couldn't think of the terminology then.
I think they were over the weekend, or all the games, all the group games were over a weekend.
So then.
The Women's Academy have won tonight, yeah.
Yeah, they're playing today. They battered Warrington 74 points to nil. It's the perfect start for the Academy team. Some really good signs for the women's team.
Strength to strength, hopefully.
Yeah, the wheelchair team has. Been doing really well. They've got a double header on at Robin Park coming up. Some really, really good things going on across the club for all the academies. The junior age groups have been doing really, really well. Unfortunately, the game on Friday that they played against Leeds was called off due to an injury. And we wish the lad the best of luck.
Yeah, well, a friend of mine said that Douglas had come off on crutches for Wigan. And obviously, he's tipped to go on to great things. And then another Leeds player had come off on crutches. And then obviously, this lad has had quite a serious injury compared to the other two. So yeah, we wish him all the best. If they've had to cancel a game, they've had to make that decision.
They don't make them decisions like that.
No.
We'd like to wish the lad the best of luck and hope everything ends up all right.
Yeah, hope he's back to it soon enough.
So then in news around rugby league, the World Cup.
Big story.
2 weeks ago, we did a thing about how we wanted to really boost the international game and fix it. And then we find out that the Rugby League World Cup in 2025 isn't going to be held in France.
We had a bit of fun the last 2 weeks with the Rugby League random story, unprofessional thing, with Ken Seo's pothole and then the Raging Bull at the Catalan match. This week's is just unfortunate.
Yeah.
Just unfortunate the unprofessionalism of Rugby League has come out in this sort of way.
Yeah. A couple of places have already put their hands up to say it. New Zealand, the New Zealand Rugby, put a message out saying that they would host it in a Southern Hemisphere World Cup.
Yeah.
There's also been talk of South Africa hosting it. And a new one that I just heard is Qatar have offered to host it.
That would be bizarre.
That would be really, really bizarre.
Say New Zealand are probably going to be the favourites, aren't they? So those
it's the safest choice. My worry is in the statement that was made about 10 o'clock today, it mentioned all these options that it had. And one of them was to postpone it a year.
Can't do it. And you can't postpone a World Cup again.
Well, but then it would be on a 4-year cycle. The plan was to go to Australia in 2026 anyway, so it might just be play it there in 2026. The other option they said was to cancel it altogether. You can't cancel a World Cup.
No.
You can't just not play it. Obviously, there's reasons why you would cancel a World Cup. If there was no World Cups played during the war, for example, or if there was during COVID, the Euros obviously had to get cancelled. But you can't cancel a World Cup because...
To be fair, though, they got postponed. They didn't get cancelled.
No, I know. They were postponed.
And this is talk of genuinely cancelling the World Cup.
And this is another problem.
That can't happen. You can't cancel a World Cup because
my big annoyance...
Not other people have said they will host.
There's a long time.
There's a long time to get that plan in place and sorted.
My big annoyance with this, though, is imagine if this happened in football. They would have it fixed by the day after. The International Rugby League Board is rumoured to only be meeting again in July. 2 months that they're wasting not doing anything and coming up with plans or whatever. If this happened in football, if this happened in rugby union, if this happened in cricket, all these other top elite sports, they'd have the plan sorted, submitted, gone to whatever planning place it needs to be, speaking to whatever local government needs to organise it, and have a plan in motion by 24, 48 hours later. And in reality, we're not going to hear anything about a World Cup that's less than one away for the next 2.5 months. It's just not good enough.
Yeah, it's really, really unfortunate. It's really, really annoying. There's been a change in government with the French Parliament, and this one isn't quite so...
Pro rugby league,
but it's not making them any money, and they've just seen 4,000 people turn up at Warrington to see France lose to England easily, and it wasn't even England's like A team.
Yeah.
So I get it, but it would have been good for the sport. It would have been good for the game in France. He said he's not giving up on French rugby league. He's not giving up on the international game in France, but it's going to be so tough now.
Unfortunately, in my opinion, they might as well give up. They've got the chance to host a World Cup.
This was already the second host because America couldn't do it anymore.
They might as well just say, we're just not bothering. We'll just let it play as an amateur sport. It's really wound me up.
Yeah.
There is no foresight here. That's why I'm a little bit tempted to say, take it to South Africa. Take it to Qatar. Because... you might as well get some benefit of it being in a new place.
You might get some money. You do it in Qatar, you might get some money, some sponsorship.
Yeah. You might go to South Africa and let South Africa enter a rugby league side, even though they don't play it. There's a lot of players that play rugby union. A lot of players playing that may have some form of heritage. just give it a go.
I don't know.
I'll see what comes out, but it's unfortunate, like you say, for the tournament, for the game as a whole. It's not good news, is it?
No.
But in other news, lovely images of rugby league community and family coming together for the Leeds Marathon with Kevin Sinfield running it, and very emotional images of him carrying his best mate Rob Burrows, who again does a whole rugby league fan community we're rooting for. And
I think it's a really tough thing to talk about because words can't give credit to how much of a good friend Kevin Sinfield is, and the work that he's done to help Rob and to help MND, the MND research. Words can't put into power how much he's done. It's really is amazing what he's doing.
He said he picked him up out of the chair and walked him over the line because he didn't want to get beat. He said we had to cross it together.
Yeah.
And then they did. And obviously Rob's wife Lindsay also completed it. Which is such a mammoth effort itself. Finding the way to look after Rob and the kids and still train for a marathon.
These are the things...
Never not impressed.
...that rugby league do.
I'm never not impressed with this story.
It is unbelievable how well we really do come together, and I think more should be made of the things that Kevin Sinfield has done to try and support his mate.
Well, it's got rugby league on the front page, hasn't it?
I love the fact that if you go into Robin Park, they've got a picture up of Sinfield and Burrows.
Mm.
And I think the quote is, everyone needs mates like this. And I think that sums it up pretty well. Two mates who clearly love each other, and the work, Kevin is doing absolutely everything he can to support his friend.
Yeah. More good news for the club was the opening of the 1872 Lounge in Irwin Park Arena with Wayne's Bar.
Yeah.
And Wayne himself pouring the first pint this evening. It looks fantastic. They've taken a lot of the trophies from the DW Stadium over to Robin Park, which is something that some of the fans have been asking for a while. That's our own place, you know. Robin Park, it's our own place. We train there. We should host all our events there. Mm. So to have our heritage boards open, have our old seats from Central Park open, have our posters and our trophies in the cabinets, they look really smart, and I'm really impressed with that, really pleased with it.
Yeah.
It's going to be a good place, can't wait to get in there, and it'll be... Yeah, be having a look at it, see what it's about. So is it in Robin Park? It used to be called the
Kingfisher Lounge, I believe, and I know the Riversiders did meet there a few times. But yeah, it's above, like where the fan village is, it's a floor up from that. Mm, so when you first walk into the fan village, it's upstairs.
Right, okay.
Right, time to move on to predictions.
Okay.
So, NRL predictions, three games. I've picked them. I've not told you who I'm picking.
No.
First up, we've got the Sharks versus the Knights.
I'm going to back the Sharks.
I'm going to go Sharks as well.
I'm going to go Sharks. I've just missed one that I'm going to pick instead. It's the first game this week. Broncos versus the Panthers up at Suncorp.
This is a tough one. This is a really tough one. I'm going to go for momentum, and I'm going to go for Penrith.
I'm going to go Penrith because I believe Broncos are missing Reynolds, aren't they? Because he's failed his HIA, so I think that pushes it in Penrith's favour.
I'm going to go Broncos. I think at Suncorp, they have to bounce back.
Yeah, at all.
I think that's going to be a massive factor. Now, another game. I know you say I always pick this game, but the Dolphins play the Storm. I'm just trying to check where it's at because obviously they play their games at different stadiums. It's going to be at Dolphin Oval.
That's in Redcliffe.
Yeah, in Redcliffe. That'll be a really interesting game.
I'm looking forward to that one.
Yeah.
And I think I'm going to back the Dolphins.
I'm going to go Melbourne.
The Finns.
We knew what was coming there.
Come on, the Finns. Okay. So it's the Challenge Cup this week. First up,
eight fixtures.
I'm going to leave Wigan Leeds till the end, obviously. First game to look at, Wakefield versus Lee.
Lee, next.
You'd be stupid. Yeah. You'd be stupid not to pick Lee, right?
Halifax, St. Helens, Matty?
Well, St. Helens.
St. Helens.
I'm going to back Halifax.
No, you're not.
I am.
Stupid.
I am.
Stop it.
I'm trying to hope it into fruition.
Are you going to put money on it?
No.
Of course you're not.
But I also would never put money on St. Helens, so that argument fails. Well,
I suppose.
Hull KR Batley. All three of us have gone Hull KR.
Well, that's
strong.
Now, an all Super League clash coming up here. Catalans versus Warrington at Catalans.
Yeah.
Lewis, you have a thing about backing Catalans at all?
It's been made a thing on the podcast now, so I can't ever break it. So because Catalan went home, I'm going to back Catalan.
I've gone Warrington, Matty.
I've gone for Warrington as well.
Another all Super League. Salford versus Huddersfield. I've gone Salford, Matty.
Yeah, I've gone Salford as well. Lewis, you always back Huddersfield. What are you doing?
Well, I'm sick of backing Huddersfield and letting me down. So this week, I've gone to back the other team instead. So I'm backing Salford in this one. And knowing my luck, Huddersfield will win, and it'll be the time when they turn it around.
Ian Watson, that's your fault.
Yep. And now, Castleford versus Hull FC. It is at Cass, the Menderhors jungle. Matty, who are you going?
I'm going momentum again. I'm going with Hull FC.
Yeah, I'm going to agree with Matty, Hull FC.
I'm going to go Cass.
If Cass won all the games you'd backed them, they'd be in the top four.
Yeah, that's the point, though. That's the point. They have to get some wins at some point. That's why I was debating Wakey before. No, I wasn't. I can't. I just can't find a way that they will ever win. Now, an all-championship tussle.
Yeah.
York versus London. Matty, who are you going?
I'll be honest, these two teams are quite even for me. I don't know that much about them, but I'm going to go for York.
Lewis?
I'm going to go for the capital. I'm going London.
I've gone York, purely home advantage. They're very similar in the league. That's why I've gone York. Right, last one. Leeds versus Wigan. Do I need to ask, lads? Anyone decided to back Leeds?
I'm not back.
No, I don't.
I've not backed Leeds.
Leeds by 24. I've gone Wigan. Yeah, Wigan. I'm going to back Wigan.
I'm going to back Wigan. I'm backing Wigan confidently.
Confidently?
Yeah. Wow. I said last week, Leeds will either turn up. I have a feeling Leeds were going to turn up one or the other. And it's turned up last week, so I've got to stick with what I say.
I hope you're right.
But we've got a lot to prove.
I think Wigan's got something to prove. I think you're right.
How good would a comfortable win be where we're just, like, the first half, but we're just rolling on top of them?
Mm. Yeah.
And they don't turn up, but whatever. Like, how good would that feel just after last week being humiliated?
It's what we need, I think. After the last 2 weeks, not just last week, but then losing to Holloway as well. Yeah. I think, you know, a win in a cup game can come around. It's not just a win in the cup series onto the quarterfinals, but it's also can kickstart your form back up.
We went heavy for the cup last year. I think we'll do it again this year. I think we'll go heavy. We'll go for the cup, really.
Yeah, I agree. The only worry is obviously that squad depth in with the injuries that we've got at the moment.
Headingley is a tough place to play.
Yeah. So that wraps up this podcast.
Well, you mentioned in the recording we you just done.
Yeah. So actually, I've just interviewed two members at Wigan. Roy, who is the kit man and equipment manager. And Malk, who's been the club statistician for the last 37 years, gave a real insight into what it's like at the club, what their opinions are, how the game and the club is developing. Also what it was like back in the 70s, 80s, before we were there. A lot of wealth of experience, and it was a really good and enjoyable sit down that I've had with them. So we're hoping to get that out over the weekend at some point. Might try and get it out before we go to Headingley, so people can listen to that on the way if they want. But it's a really interesting sit down.
People have given their they've given the most of their adult lives to the club, so
yes, it's the stories they're going to get from the time. Obviously, we're quite young ones out before Wigan fans, so we can't really go back. So looking back at the '70s and eighties, I think some of maybe our older listeners and viewers will appreciate that. Remember the stories and the players who they'll mention and remember watching them.
One of the highlights of it, and I won't spoil it by naming players, but they both named the 1-13 all time Wigan 13. That was a really interesting thing to see. A bit of the thought process behind who they've gone for, why they've gone for them. Other honourable mentions.
Yeah.
It was a really fascinating listen.
I mean, we were all like JJB kids, weren't we? DW Stadium kids who never been to Central Park, were too young for that. And
so I went to one game.
We were all like Super League babies.
Yeah.
You know? Mm. So
there's a lot of rugby before that.
98 I was born, Wigan won Super League at the grand final. So that's where we're coming from. We're coming from a place where we didn't see Central Park, we didn't see pre-Super League.
To be honest,
we've only watched it on YouTube.
To be honest, we do discuss some of like the low points, the relegation, fighting relegation, yeah, and also how that changed the club, actually being relegated and playing other teams. It was a really fascinating conversation.
Yeah, it's 3 hours long.
Yeah.
No, sorry, it's not.
You went there saying it was going to be 40 minutes. I'm interested to see how long it ends up.
Yeah, well, we'll see when I edit it. But thank you very much. Be sure to keep an eye out on however you listen, Spotify or Apple. Please leave a review and we'll catch you next week.
Yeah. Discovering lately, I'm a bit crazy.